डॉक्टर विजय लक्ष्मी मिश्रा।
यस हाँ यस मैम, आई इफ योर परमिशन आई विल जस्ट
यस श्योर श्योर
टेल अ लिटिल बिट डिटेल अबाउट द चेयरपर्सन एंड देन विल हैंड ओवर टू डॉक्टर त्रिपाठी सर। यस
ओके
या सो चेयरपर्सन डॉक्टर यस मैम।
No, no, did I intervene in between?
No, no, no problem, ma'am. Well, I just wanted to introduce our chairperson, Professor Rekha Das, ma'am, to everyone here before we start off the presentation with Dr. Tripathi, sir. If it is okay with you, ma'am, Rekha, ma'am.
Yes, yes.
Yes. So she is the professor and head Department of Anesthesia, Critical Care and Pain at Acharya Harihar PGI of Cancer Hospital, Cuttack. Consultant and advisor ICU Shanti Hospital Cuttack, and she has got various achievements to her credit. She is the president of ISA Odisha State Branch, secretary of ICCM Cuttack Branch, infection control chairman of AHP GIC, course coordinator of FCCN nursing critical care certificate course at Cuttack, FCCS trainer and a peer reviewer of journals, EC member of RSACP National, and she has organized several state level workshops, and she's also the editor of OMJ. Her area of expertise includes onco-critical care, difficult airway in OT and ICU, onco-sepsis, sedation in ICU, peri-op NIV in obesity, nutrition in oncology, ERAS. As she has said, she herself is an expert in ICU. So looking forward to listen to her insights on this topic. Welcome to you, ma'am. For the next chairperson, we have Dr. Pratibha. She's our associate professor as well as the in-charge head of department right now. And from IGMCRI, Puducherry. She's been a faculty for various international, national and state conferences, also awarded as the best doctor award by Lions Club, Pondicherry. She has got numerous publications, and her areas of interest include simulation and obstetric anesthesia. Very warm welcome, Pratibha. So I hand over to our esteemed Tripathi sir. I'll stop sharing now.
Hello, am I audible?
Yes, sir. One sec. I'm just stopping sharing.
A very good evening to all. And I thank Professor Rekha Das, madam, for giving a very kind introduction of mine. First of all, I'd like to thank the society RSACP for giving me this opportunity. And I would like to extend my thanks and gratitude to Professor Indrani, madam, and Professor Tej Kol sir, and Dr. Vijay for giving me this opportunity. Last but not the least, the topic which was discussed to me by my very close friend, and I would rather call family, by Dr. Vijay Lakshmi, she asked me to be very basic on this ventilator topic. I'm also very glad to see many of my friends. Of course, I would like to meet all of them physically, but at least in virtual platform from Odisha, Basan sir, Nivetita madam, and all of my friends, Bade sir, and other friends from Pondicherry. And since we are late, I'll straight away go to the topic. And before going, starting the topic, I would like to give a disclaimer that I have no conflict of interest. If I'm putting some picture of particular ventilator, I have no association with them, but just to have a academic interaction, I have placed those pictures, and many of the pictures are taken from internet, and it is only used for demonstration purpose. Now coming to the first questions, the PG mind, when they come to newly to the ventilator scenario, why should we learn graph? And it is very simple answer. If you look these numbers on the right side of your screen, there's a lot of number and doesn't make sense. But if someone puts it in this kind of pictorial form, it is easy to understand, easy to interpret. So that is the first basic, that the graph and loops has evolved from this. But when you talk about ventilator, look at the numbers which is coming in the right side of your screen, and it is constantly changing. In ICU, we have to monitor all the parameters continuously. Similarly, the lung parameter, the volume, flow, everything will be coming in numbers. So if you are looking at this number it is quite difficult to make sense of it. Yes, we need to look at the numbers, but particular values if you are looking at. But to have a broad picture, we always have to depend. We mostly depend on the graphs, graphical representation of the same numbers which has been recorded by the ventilator. Now, but then when we look at this the graphs, sometimes we are lost by the modern ventilator. If you look, the graphs are made so beautiful, so many times you do not know what those graphs, and some pictorials are also being added. So just not to being lost between those beautiful graphs, what we have to be careful about is we have to understand the graph, how the graph is generated, what it represents, how to interpret it. But once learning the graph is not sufficient, we have to every day, whenever we go and use the ventilator, we need to use this graphical representation regularly. Then only we can be more expert or more convenient with the graphical. Now, in the next 30 minutes, I would like to cover the topic in three phases: the basic ventilator, basics of the ventilator graphics, how to interpret this graphs, and then few abnormal graphs for exam purpose. I will not go for very detailed interpretation of those graphs because it will take time, but few common graphs which comes into the exam, I'll try to cover it. Now, before going into the ventilator graphics, we have to keep two things in mind. First thing is this particular beautiful diagram by Mohsin, where it shows that the volume, flow, and pressure are interlinked by a mathematical formula, which is known as equation of motion. That is, P is equal to elastance into volume plus resistance into flow. This is what we have to keep, because that keeps in playing in every time we look into a graph. Second thing is, and the compliance can be calculated from it. Second thing which I want everybody to keep in their mind is the lung doesn't fill in a single go. If you blow air inside positive pressure ventilation or take negative pressure ventilation also, the lung will take time to ventilate, to fill. That is because of the difference of the airway resistance, and this is what is called as a time constant. The time constant is a time taken for airway pressure changes to equilibrate throughout the lung. So, or in simpler word, rapidity of lung filling. In normal lung, though we call it homogeneous, but again, based on the West zone, it varies, but we take it as a homogeneous filling of the lung. So 67% is one time constant, then by this is what one time constant, two time constant, and three time constant. By three time constant, 95% of the lung is filled. So this is thing which we have to keep it in our mind. And the time constant mathematically is resistance into compliance of that particular lung. But in pathology, the compliance and resistance in the zone also can change. So time constant, the filling of a particular zone in a particular lung can also vary. Now, the another important basics which we have to keep it in our mind is how the graph which we are seeing are generated. So control unit or the ventilator control unit deliver the gas, that is air oxygen mixture, to the patient. And from the patient, the data, the ventilator data is collected. That is the pressure, flow, and volume data is collected by sensor, given to the interface, and the interface or the computer chip sitting in the interface does a lot of calculation. These data come into that. So certain data are monitored data, certain data are computed data, like compliance, resistance, and all other data are computed data. After doing this computation real time, every breath the data are being generated, this data are again put into graphical pattern in a two different graphical pattern, which we will be discussing subsequently. So the values are measured at one particular point, and then those values are calculated, a few more values are calculated, added, and the graphs are generated. Now again, when we look from where the data is coming, that it is like it can be closer to the patient end, or it can be at the machine end, in the inspiratory and expiratory. The sensor are placed at different places. Inspiration and expiration limb it can be placed, or it can be placed closer to the patient end. Everything has its own advantage, disadvantage. Different type of sensors are there. We will not go into detail of that. But what we do when we are interpreting is the data which we are seeing, we assume or we presume that the data is a real interpretation of what is happening inside the lung. So the most closest and accurate data would be that if you put a sensor inside the trachea and then take the sampling from there and measure the, generally we measure the flow and pressure, and volume is calculated because flow over time is volume. So we assume, and the ventilator assume, and everybody, we while interpreting, we assume that it is a true representation of the thing which is changing inside the lung. But it doesn't happen that way. Some measurement fallacy, measurement error also come into play. So this is what we have to be careful. So whenever, whatever ventilator we are using, we should know that where, from where the measurement is happening, so that any other troubleshooting or anything which is abnormal, which is not being explained by the clinical changes in the patient, can be root back to this kind of causes. Now, the initially, like 20, 25 years back, the only digital data were coming, and very real time pulling that data and putting that into a graphical pattern was difficult. When subsequently this kind of graphs came into picture, where slow plotting of that and real time plotting was not there. Initially, there was only fixed, after a few seconds, one graph or loop used to come. But then if you look at the current ventilator, almost all ventilators will give you real time and graphical data. And even most advanced ventilator will include some different kind of interface where you can take that, like oxygenation, carbon dioxide and inhalation, and a pictorial. This is one example, is that the compliance resistance is being given in a pictorial format, which is dynamic pictorial format, where compliance and resistance is being given into picture. But we'll not be discussing it. I'm just giving this as the system are advancing more and more. Pictorial formats or graphical formats have been incorporated in different ventilators. Now coming to the basics, so we the graphs are basically divided into two, scalars and loop. Scalar is one particular value, like pressure, volume, or flow, plotted over time. It is a linear graph where the pressure, volume, or flow is plotted against the time. Loop is any of these two parameters you plot against each other, then it forms a loop. So two display two variable, if you put in a x-axis and y-axis and then put it, it will become a loop. We'll go into detail of that and subsequently. And what are this this class scalar and loop gives us? So from this, I'm just that list can go long, but I've just broadly divided into four category. From this scalar and loop, we can analyze what type of volume is being, what type of breath is being delivered to the patient. By that itself, we can know that what mode the patient is on. Even not looking at the mode, sometimes the interpreting the mode also, because there is so much different nomenclature by different companies for the same mode. So by looking at the graph, you can very well know that what mode patient is on. Second thing is, it sometime, or rather I will say most of the time, it helps in adjustment of our ventilator setting, like IE times, ramp and other things, where the synchrony becomes better with the patient. So we have to we can use this graphs to get a better synchrony by adjusting the ventilator setting. And then it also helps in diagnosing pathology, lung pathology. And it also helps us in troubleshooting. If the patient is not getting adequate ventilation, some asynchrony is happening, we are not able to find out the graphs can give us a very good clue that what is going on in scalar. So coming to that scalar, as I have already mentioned that either the flow, pressure, or volume is plotted against the time. If you look at the x-axis, this is the 1 second, 2 second, 3 second, 4 second, 5 second, 6 second. This again, like ECG, it can be increased, it can be decreased. The timeline can be made 30 seconds, the timeline can be made 1 minute based on the ventilator type and the options in the ventilator. And the y-axis is the unit of that particular parameter. Here, if you look at that, it is centimeter of water pressure. But here, if you look at it, is a liter per minute. Here, if you look at it, is ml. So the unit is in the left side, and the x-axis is the y-axis is the unit, and the x-axis is the time. Based on this, we call them as pressure scalar, volume scalar, and flow scalar. And this again, this graphical pattern can be called, or based on the visual pattern, we can call it as a square pattern, we can call it as a sinusoid pattern, we can call it as a ascending ramp or a descending ramp or a decaying ramp, like that we can call it. It is only a visual description of that particular graph, but it is frequently used. The terminologies are frequently used to describe one particular graph. Now coming to the first scalar, that is the flow scalar. The reason being talking about the flow scalar is almost all ventilator, even if you put it in volume mode or even if you put it in pressure mode, the delivery is by generating a flow. The flow is generated by that a pressure difference is being made, and then the volume is being delivered. So we have to be very thorough with how the air is being delivered or the flow is happening to the patient. So look at the point A. If you think that we are recording it inside the trachea of the patient, there was no flow, no air was going inside the patient. And since it's a constant flow mode, which I put in the graph, so immediately the pre-calculated flow will happen to the trachea, and the flow will reach to the point B. It can be 15 liter, it can be 30 liter, it can be 45 liter. It is decided by the user and most of the time being calculated and adjusted by the ventilator. And that flow is a constant flow pattern. So what happens is at this point of time, from B to C, the flow will be constant. So let us say that 20 liter flow is generated and the 20 liter is maintained for the time of inspiration minus the plateau time. If you have added some plateau time into the TI, that will be at the onset of the plateau time. What happens is the flow is stopped and then the flow becomes immediately zero. But the expiration doesn't happen. The cycling doesn't happen. And then during expiration, though you see that a nice square flow pattern in the inspiration, but expiration being a passive process immediately because of the elastic recoil, the graphical look at this end is mostly almost every patient, you will have this decaying type of graph, but the length, width, and the surface area under this graph will be varying. That we will be discussing when we'll discuss particular pathological format. Now, the flow scalar is one kind of scalar where we can see all that five type which I have described in my the visual description of the graph. You can see square pattern, you can see descending ramp, you can see descent decelerating ramp, and then you can see sine, and then you can see decelerative. So, and from this, you can also differentiate that this three kind of pattern generally happens in mandatory pattern breaths, and this two kind of pattern generally happens in a spontaneous breath. So breath differentiation also can be made. And then come to this is a different flow pattern, and this flow pattern happens generally in the pressure ventilation. Why it happens? Because here the target given for the ventilator is to set or reach one particular pressure. So while initially the flow is generated, a pre-calculated flow, and the pressure is reached. But to maintain that pressure to all the inspiratory time, the flow need not be this high, because as I have explained initially, there is a differential filling of the lung, that time constant concept. So the flow required to maintain that amount of pressure is less. So the flow automatically reduced by the ventilator, and it is like a decelerating flow. And then the expiration happens once the inspiratory time is over. And this particular phase is again the inspiratory pause. Now coming to the pressure scalar. Pressure scalar, here I have plot, the pressure scalar also can be of different type, but here it is a volume regulated or volume controlled pressure scalar. What you can see here is, and the point A, but there is a gap between the zero to point A, and this height is PEEP. So if you have set some PEEP, the pressure will start from that PEEP pressure. So suppose we have started given, if you take this as 5, so it is 6 centimeter of water pressure is a PEEP. So from here, the flow has started and the pressure has risen, And the pressure, once the differential filling is happening, lung is getting filled, the pressure will, the slope will happen, and then you will reach to the peak inspiratory pressure. Once the peak inspiratory pressure is there, suppose you have not applied a inspiratory pause, from here itself the expiration will start. But since we are talking about an example of where the inspiratory pause is being applied, so what happens is the flow is stopped. Since the lung filling is continuing, the pressure will drop and it will stop here. This is the D to E is known as the plateau pressure. This is the peak pressure. C is peak pressure. D, E, E place is the plateau pressure. So the C to D, this gradient is mainly because of the dynamic component, and the D to E, this phase is because of fixed. So this particular part can talk about the compliance, the static compliance. And if you minus this two, it will become the resistance compliance. So from taking measurement from this, you can calculate the compliance. You can also calculate the resistance. So if you apply a plateau pressure, inspiratory pause, you get a peak pressure, you get a plateau pressure, you can calculate all the compliance and resistance which you want to calculate. So coming to the pressure scalar and pressure control. So pressure scalar and pressure control is very simple, because we have asked the ventilator to give a flow to achieve one particular pressure. Suppose let us say we have given here a pressure target of 22. So it has reached 22 and it has stopped. So all the inspiratory time the pressure is being maintained. Only thing which you see here, it is not a sudden rise, it has a slope. This can be regulated. This we call it as a ramp. You can put it as a zero, then it will become almost straight. And then if you can keep a slope. So you, based on the patient lung condition, you can adjust this ramp. Coming to the volume scalar, volume scalars are simple scalars, and means it is very simple. It is inspiration has happened and then expiration has happened. Inspiration, if there is a fixed flow, then the inspiration will be almost as linear pattern, and the expiration also is little decaying but curvilinear. You cannot see that like flow pattern. It will be, if you do not look at very closely, you always think it is a linear, but it will have some, because of it is a basic process expiration, it is like this. But if you apply a plateau pressure, plateau inspiratory pause, what will happen is once the volume is reached, the volume will be hold for some more time. So this is the inspiration phase and this is the expiration phase in the volume scalar. So if you compare this volume scalar with the scalar with flow, this is when we apply a inspiratory pause. This is when you do not apply a inspiratory pause. Now the breath type, as I have mentioned earlier, the breath type which is being delivered to the patient can be determined by looking at all three scalar, pressure, volume, and flow scalars. And you have to look for a little more breaths, like at least 10 to 15 or 20 breaths you have to look. And then find out what is the trigger. It is a time trigger, present trigger. What is the limit? What is the cycle? And what is the expiration phase? All four factors, if you take into account, you can have fair idea about what mode the patient is getting breath delivered from the ventilator. Now, this is a tool which we generally use in most of the ventilator you will have. So first of all, this scalars, the pressure, volume, and flow scalars should not be independently. It can be, but if you have to have a proper idea about what is happening inside the lung, you have to read all three in a same time frame. So it is plotted in the same time frame. So look at what is happening to the pressure changes, corresponding the flow changes, and corresponding the volume changes. If I move the cursor to a particular point, there is this, at this point that is 24 ml and the flow is happening is 30 liter and the pressure which is in the airway is 14 centimeter of water pressure. So to interpret a particular lung condition, we have to analyze all three scalar at particular point of time, and then you can go back and forth and look at those values. So modern ventilator automatically does this, take all this ventilator parameter, which is actually it is reverse. These parameters are being monitored and the graph is generated. But here we are trying to see those exact parameter what at one particular time point, what is happening. So this is how we should interpret. The next thing is the loops. As I said, it can be, it is set plotting of two variable in x and y axis. So the first loop which we are discussing is PV or the pressure volume loop. What is happening here is the pressure is in the x axis and the volume is in the y axis. So if you take multiple entries, what is happening in the each pressure, what is the volume, you can get this curve. When there is a positive pressure ventilation and a machine breath, what happens is the loop stays on the right side of the y axis. And so this is the red one is the volume during the inflation. The green one is the volume during deflation. So this is how the machine breath is delivered and the PV loop is generated. But if you look at a PV loop of a spontaneously breathing patient, you can see the inspiration part falling onto the left side of the y-axis. That is the negative side of the exit pressure, because the spontaneous breath is a negative pressure ventilation. But when you apply pressure support, then the graph will again shift towards the right side. So why should we look? We know that the from the equation of motion that PV and the flow, pressure volume and flow are interlinked. So what additional data this PV loops give? It gives two hidden parameters in a pictorial format. If you look at the equation of motion, the elastance or rather compliance and resistance are hidden. So if these things are fixed, then the PV loop or loop will look same. But if there is any change in the compliance or the resistance, the loop shape and size will change. That is how we easily pick up the changes in the compliance and resistance. That is why this loop is very, very important, because it immediately gives you a pictorial view of what is happening to the pathology. That is the compliance, resistance, any problem has happened. For example, here, if you look, what is happening, this is a standard PV loop. And here, if you look, the PV, the loop has gone, will become more slanted. So the angle which was 45 degrees has now become 30 degrees. It is less horizontal. That means for a given pressure, the volume raise is less. That is why the loop has become, so though the volume pressure, everything may be delivered, but the degree is changed, and that can be easily seen from the PV loop. Now coming to this is another the shape of PV loop which happens inside when you are doing a pressure control ventilation. Here the loop become little squarer. And then the next one is the flow volume loop, which is again the flow is in the y-axis and the volume is in the x-axis. The inspiration is in the top, expiration is in the bottom. So inspiration has happened, it has reached, and it has gone to expression. It is also a very important tool. Lot of information can be drawn. Again, the shape and size of the thing can be a little different when you are looking at the pressure mode. These are all representative images. It is not exact. So so just to have an idea that the pressure mode, the PV, your flow volume loop looks little different. Now, the last part of my talk, I'll be very quickly, because I know that another 5 minutes is there. So I'll be just addressing the clinical application. So I'll give you example of this graphical interface used in clinical. The first thing, look at the flow scalar. What is happening here is the flow is not reaching to the zero point. And then, so inspiration is ended here, but the flow has not reached. And the expression has started. That means the inspiration time is not adequate for that particular lung. So what you have to do, you have to make adjustment so that the inspiration is, this is like inspiration is over, but the cycling is not happening. This is again too short. Sorry, this is too short a inspiration time. This is too long a inspiration time. Ideal inspiration is like inspiration ends, the flow reaches to zero and the expiration. So this is what I was mentioning, that looking at these parameters, we can adjust our, in this particular example, we can adjust our IE time by different settings. Similarly, as I was talking about the pressure rise time, I would like to see this kind of pressure scaler when I am doing a pressure control ventilation. If you are looking at this, then the rise time is too high. So the pressure reaching, the set pressure is reached over a period of longer time. So that volume delivery may not be very adequate. So I adjust and get it. If I am putting it very straight, I can have a overshoot. This is called as pressure overshoot. So if it is very straight, because of the flow generation and stopping of flow, it can sometime overshoot and go. So pressure overshoot can happen. So looking at this, you can adjust your ramp. Now look at this graph where what has happened is the expiration here is very long and here it is less. So this is just for giving an example that this is a prolonged expiration time. It is a normal expiratory time. It can generally happen. And look at the peak expiratory flow. Here the peak expiratory flow is less. Here the peak expiratory flow is more. What is the condition? Generally we see it in the bronchial asthma. And this is before bronchodilator therapy. It is after bronchodilatation. And now again in this graph, the graph is the expiratory flow is not reached to the baseline. It is falling short. And again, the inspiration has started. This generally happens because of autopeep. There is some amount of air is trapped. All the air which is gone in has not come out. So the expiratory flow has not reached to the baseline. So this is what is a condition of air trapping or autopeep, which we commonly call it as autopeep. So again, we need to adjust our ventilator setting so to avoid this. Now look at this pressure scalar again. If you look at the P plateau to P peak inspiratory pressure height, it is more. Here the plateau pressure is high. So generally this is where the resistance is more. This is where the compliance is less. So as I said, this is the static compliance. This is the dynamic compliance. Dynamic minus static compliance is the resistance component. So by looking different, if the peak pressure is quite high from the plateau pressure, you know that there is some amount of bronchospasm or airway obstruction is happening. And if the plateau pressure itself is increasing, that means that lung compliance is decreasing. But if you do not apply a inspiratory pause, then you may not see this plateau pressure and you will not have the idea about resistance. And so if you are not using inspiratory pause and you are ventilating, the pressure curve may look like this. At this point, if you want to get that, then you have to, all the ventilator gives you a mode called inspiratory hold. You hold the inspiration for at least 10 seconds to get a good plateau pressure idea, because as per the AIDS net, we are supposed to ventilate based on the plateau pressure. Plateau pressure and driving pressure are the two pressure, which is a very integral part of our lung protective ventilation. Now look at this, what has happened here is, this is a peep as I have described before, but if you look at this particular area, the patient trigger has happened. So the pressure has fallen below the set peep. That means the patient has tried to take effort and then the inspiration has started. And here again, you see what has happened. This is the set peep, but at this point, the baseline pressure is high. So this can happen because of this air trapping or the autopeep, which we call it as autopeep. If you look at the volume scalar and you look, the volume is not reaching to the baseline. That means you are losing a volume somewhere during the expiration or there is air trapping. If you see this kind of volume scalar, then you should be worried about a leak, or mostly it will be because of air trapping. Now coming to few abnormal loops, I'll be very quick about this. So this is the PB loop. I have already discussed about the compliance, less compliant loop, how it goes and slip, slant down to the towards the x-axis. This is another thing which we call it as a bicking, or when too much of flattening happens, that is when you are over distending the lung by setting a very high peep and your pressures are high. So high peep setting, you can see a bicking of the PV loop. Then again, in case of volume loss, you can look at this PV loop, and what is happening is the expiration is again not reaching to the baseline. So this is the amount of, this is, since this y-axis is about volume, so if you can exactly measure what amount of volume is being lost. So this is the volume which has gone inside the lung. This is the amount of volume which has come out of the lung. So this much is the volume loss. Then another thing is you can see that if inspiratory resistance is increased, you can see the slanting of the inspiratory limb. Then your scalloping can be seen if you, there is a expiratory resistance. So the inspiration and expiration resistance also can be assessed by the flow volume loop. Now the leak, how it looks in a flow volume loop, again, in the expiration, there is a leak. So what happens is it touches the baseline very earlier. So there is certain amount of volume which is lost, which is not returned back to the ventilator. Now auto peep, what happens? The flow volume loop, the expiratory limb again doesn't reach to zero. Here it was ending early. Here what has happened is it is not reaching to the baseline. This again, because of air trapping, all the volume has not come out. So it is air is trapped and auto peep is generated. Again, if you see the fluttering or mild fluctuation in the inspiration or expiration limb, most of the time it happens in the both the limb, then you should know that it is because of some fluid inside the trachea. It can be secretion, or mostly if you are using active humidification, the water condensation also will give you like this. So if the measurement is happening in at the ventilator end and there is a water which is moving in your circuit, also will give like this. Now if you are looking at the flow volume loop and this is going like this, and the pressure volume curve also has a big has a depression, so this can be because of flow starvation or asynchrony. Again, you need to readjust your ventilator so that this flow volume, see what is happening here is the inspiration has started, but the flow has been delivered, the flow was not sufficient, it has reached to zero. Again, it has restarted and it is trying to deliver the flow. It also sometimes happens because of faulty ventilator functioning. So both the things has to be checked. Same thing when you are looking at the PV loop, you can have a dent in the expiratory limb as well as sometime in the inspiratory limb. So both the things has to be analyzed properly. So the last but not the least, which I pointed out, once we know what we have to look for, we have to keep on looking this during our clinical practice. Thank you. I would be happy to take any questions if anybody has.
Ma'am, you need to unmute yourself.
Please,
ma'am,
unmute yourself.
Unmute yourself, Dr. Pratibha.
Not audible.
You're not audible. Just unmute yourself.
She's already unmute, ma'am. Actually,
yeah.
Somehow there's an audio problem.
Okay. You are unmuted only, but just check the volume of your speaker, no? Pratibha.
Can you hear us? Can she hear us?
Vijayalakshmi?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Can you hear us, Pratibha?
Yes, no. Pratibha,
she's
member.
Unmuted. She has to unmute herself. Kindly Dr. unmute Pratibha yourself. Yes, now she's unmuted, I think. Yeah. No?
She's not audible.
Not audible. Okay, can I ask one question before we wait for her?
Yes, yes. I know we should carry on. Okay.
Can I just ask one question from
you? Yes, yes, sure, sure.
Tripathi sir has been our senior here working with us, so I take the privilege to ask the first question. A very small question, since we have a lot of postgraduates here. What is the first thing that you suggest them that they have to start off reading initially? Because a lot of these loops and scalars you have talked about. As a starter, say it's a first year postgraduate coming for the first time to the CCU, which is the one that you suggest that they should start looking at and master? So from there, they can start on like learning one by one.
Yeah. So as I said, most of the standard textbook gives a basic description of all scalar and loop. So take any standard textbook and you will find it. Even our basic NSSA textbook in their critical care and mechanical ventilation, it does. But what is more important for the beginner, that is why I was taking more time in describing how it is being generated and how you should read. So you have to regularly see it. That is why, like let us say that you start with a flow scalar. So you have read the flow scalar, regularly follow the flow scalar. You can all three scalar, you can read. It is not a very big deal, but only thing is you have to repeatedly see. And when you are observing this, what will happen is you will come across very abnormal findings, which your seniors and the consultant will help. At some time, there is a ventilator problem, sometimes some other problems, and n number of materials are available in the internet, YouTube, you can look at it. But only thing is what the mind doesn't know, eye doesn't see. So the first thing is how it is to be read and what are the things which you have to point out. So you have to stress, like let us see that I am talking about a flow scalar. So how, where the flow is, what is happening, where the inspiration has started, how the inspiration is progressing, how the inspiration is end, and what is happening. In between, what is happening to the flow, what is happening to the volume, what is happening to the pressure. So if you start from this basic and slowly you will build upon this. That is how one can learn. It takes, at least for me, it took quite a long time to learn. So, but the present generation can learn it faster.
Can I just add one point?
Please.
Actually, he has said very well, because by just teaching the student, it is not sufficient. When you show them certain abnormalities in the graph and normal graph, only then the students start registering. But what I would just like to say is, they always need to remember that whenever a ventilator is delivering a breath, be it in a volume control or a pressure control or whatever it may be, the inspiration is what the ventilator is doing, and the expiration is what the patient is doing. So mostly that is why when we look at the inspiratory cycle, we see lot of things that come to our mind. But we need to remember that the inspiration has to be started by the ventilator, and the mode it is started can be by the ventilator or that is a trigger that you need to understand. What triggers the ventilator into inspiration? Whether it is through the ventilator or whether it is by the patient, and if it is by the ventilator, what kind of a mode it is, and then what is the target where it stops. Well, that is where the role of volume the volume control or the flow mode or the pressure control comes into play. And then you need to know what the cycle is, how it is cycled onto the expiration, whether it is done by the as per time or as per maybe flow in certain situations. So these are certain basic things which apply to all the modes of ventilator. So these, if you understand the trigger, the target, the cycling of the ventilator, then probably you, as you work on it slowly, you come to know one by one. And as he said so well, as Dr. Tripathi said very well, you need to see many graphs to identify what is a normal graph, what is an abnormal graph. And the more you use them, you will come to understand them better. Thank you. It was very wonderful. The way he showed all those graphs, they were very nice.
Thank you, madam. Thank you.
Dr. Pratibha, would you like to speak now? Are you audible? Have you plugged in with your earphones?
Yeah, she's, I think, plugged in with her earphones.
Please, yeah. No?
Okay. Rupati sir can give some suggestions what to do. He is with the MacBook. So.
No, Pratibha doesn't want to talk
to me. Can you please just try with your microphones, inbuilt microphones in your earphones? Please just try through that, ma'am. Have you tried that?
So in the chat box, what I had asked, same thing. I think Dr. Sri Lakshmi has also put in the chat box similar thing. She was my mentor in Vijayawada.
Can you hear through your earphones, please?
Can Dr. Tripathi highlight... Can Dr. Tripathi highlight a few words on the ventilator? He has started, I think he has innovated. It's very thing of interest.
I think when the last year the pandemic was starting and we were scared of the shortage of ventilator, myself with two more professor from IIT Roorkee, we started a project to develop an indigenous ICU ventilator. We developed it within 45 days. With, of course, they had a team of around 14-15 students. But unfortunately, in India, what happens is those things doesn't come into market. We wanted to keep the cost less than 1 lakh with a full-fledged ICU ventilator, all monitoring, all everything put together. So maybe in a month time, we'll be see it in market. And we are very particular to keep it the cost on the lower side. That is why the manufacturing is a little difficult, but we do not want any profit. So that is why, what about the Pranabai ventilator, which we try to do. But fortunately, within the last 1 year, country had sufficient number of ventilator and most of the people got it. At that point of time, it was a panicky, and with that we started. But we had a vision to develop a fully functional ICU ventilator, not some ambu squeezers and the volume dividers which were coming at that point of time. That was the story behind it. Thank you, madam. Thank you so much.
Okay, finish.
So there are other questions.
Can you elaborate on the patents which you have, sir, on all the four patents, sir?
Yeah, sir. One is on one is where the where, again all my patents are low cost. 3 year one is granted, 3 year under evaluation. So again, one is we have developed one with one of my colleague again from Pondicherry, Dr. Prasanna Vadanan. We have developed one video stellate, that is a video scope, and we are expecting that to be less than 5,000. And we have got a grant from one GC, that is one granting authority has given 10 lakhs to develop that. It is under process, and very soon we'll have that product, maybe in a 3 months time. There's you have to buy a stillet and take a disposable camera, which comes, it's a non-medical camera, which comes in around, the scope will be medical grade, and the camera which goes inside the scope will be non-medical grade. So that is what is our view. So that is the patent which we got, and the two different patent on the same ventilator which we have developed. There are two different technology which we have used. Another one is home-based ventilatory care respiratory monitoring with the AI platform which we have developed. It is partly developed yet, so it is also patent has been filed and the work is being done. So that is regarding my patent work, sir.
Excellent, sir. Excellent.
Still audio we are not getting from Pratibha.
So,
we're having some kind of audio issues with Pratibha, I think.
We can ask her to put something in the chat box there.
Yeah,
something. Yeah, that will be something better.
She's actually logged out and logged in again to just check. So, any other questions from you, Rekha?
Is this
your inputs from your experience in the ICU?
Talking to me?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. No, this in the COVID pandemic, we actually had a very, very bad time, in the sense that when we went from non-invasive ventilation to invasive ventilation, actually some of our patients crashed. So then we came to know that we had to adjust our setting. That was the first time when we started giving no PEEP to our patients. So we came down with a PEEP, zero PEEP. And which we started calling as ZEEP, zero end expiratory pressure. And then we used to have a minute ventilation of around 30-40 liters to meet the oxygenation of the patient. So this was something which was an experience to many of us. And initially we used to put a patient on volume control settings. So that used to deliver a fixed tidal volume and a fixed minute ventilation. So we used to not know, get a clue about the thing. Then later on, when we started putting them on pressure and then we increased our minute ventilation. We used to go with a respiration rate very high as 26, 28, like that. And then we used to get a desired minute ventilation. And then that was the time we really came to know that a concept of ZIP existed in these kind of patients. And then we used, and such high ventilation had to be given to the patient to meet the requirement of the patient. So when they were hyperventilating and all. So this was an experience for all of us during the COVID era. And some of you can also share their experience. This was something which I just wanted to say.
I have not included any loops and graphs from non-invasive ventilation. So when we look at those graphs and loops, when the patient is on non-invasive ventilation, it will be a little difficult to interpret because inherently most of the time there will be a leak. So the volume which goes in and comes out doesn't match. But whenever we are putting the ventilator which are capable of doing a non-invasive ventilation, particularly ICU ventilator with non-invasive mode, they take into account of the sum losses and they try to adjust that in their graphical representation. But sometime it will not be matching. Another time it also helps actually. If you look at, if you are looking at the volume graph and you are looking at the flow scalar, volume scalar, and suddenly there is a leak, the patient, the leak has increased over a period of time. Your patient has not noticed and the ventilator is not compensating. You can easily pick it up by looking at the graphs. I have not put those graphs because of lack of time. So I have not included non-invasive ventilatory graphs. They are a little different from the invasive ventilatory graphs. So some, one should put some time to learn that too.
But whenever you are putting a patient on a ventilator, you must follow them. That is the bottom line. You can't put a setting and then you can just forget about it. You have to be constantly vigilant after every maybe 2 hours, 1 hour. Initially, maybe as close as half an hour, 1 hour and 2 hours. And later on, maybe once your patient stabilizes, then you can do it at a longer interval. That is the bottom line of all ventilator, whenever you are putting a patient on a ventilator.
So we have a couple of questions. I think Santosh, someone was saying about the ventilator settings in COVID patient.
So I can take that question if time permits. I do not know how much time.
One question, we can take.
Yeah. So when we are talking about COVID ventilation, I will be very brief. Two things we have to keep in mind. One is oxygenation and second thing is workup breathing. So if oxygenation is maintained by HFNC or oxygen supplementation by whatever NRBM or mask, and the workup breathing is acceptable, then that is fine. The workup breathing is too high, definitely the patient is landing into trouble. So the clinical correlation from a say CT score may sometime differ. Sometimes the clinically the patient will be worse, the CT score will be good. CT score will be very bad, the patient is clinically good. So what we need to treat is the respiratory clinical finding, that is oxygenation and workup breathing. So oxygenation is only hampered, workup breathing is okay, supplemental oxygen is doing with proning, self-proning, that will solve the problem. Even with 20 by 25, we have kept the patient on prone and they have recovered with the constant proning and oxygenation, they have recovered. And then otherwise, we then go for non-invasive ventilation. Again, we go for non-invasive ventilation. Our strategy is a CPAP mode. They do not generally require a lot of pressure support. A CPAP of 8 to 10 is sufficient initially. But again, look at the workup breathing. If the workup breathing is not, then you adjust your ventilator setting to get the workup breathing. Generally, these patients, whatever you do, their respiratory rate will be somewhere around 25 to 26. Is acceptable. Look at the ABG. If respiratory alkalosis is not high, that means their ventilation is all right. You have to wait for the respiratory pathology to resolve. If you are failing the respiratory oxygenation is not happening properly and then non-invasive ventilation is not sufficient, you go for invasive ventilation. But what happens in our practice is if you go all this patient after 4, 5, 6 days of non-invasive ventilation, you intubate and then try to do invasive ventilation, their oxygenation and other things are still deranged. But in our experience, the proning does help a lot. So we put invasive patient continuous proning for 18 hours, 20 hours. Sometime even continuous proning for 2 days, we have done for patients where the compliance is very less. So So these are the strategy which it is, I think it is out of the purview of this lecture, but since somebody has asked, I thought to make my points.
Thank you, sir. Rekha ma'am, any other?
No, I think that is very important. Yeah. Oxygenation and work of breathing, two things that need to be addressed.
I think that was a very lucid presentation by Tripathi sir, as usual, on ventilator graphics. It will be very useful for the postgraduates as well as all of us who are working in the ICU right now. And thank you, Rekha Das ma'am, for chairing the session, giving your valuable inputs. Thank you, Pratibha. I don't know what is the audio issue. You were unmuted, but thank you a lot for being there. So we'll move on to the second topic of today's webinar. We have a case presentation on
for that point is coming from here. If we just remove the sleep, we can just sit with it.
Yes, am I audible?
Ma'am, I can write the whole book down.
Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am, yes. You're audible.
Yes, yes.
Okay. No, I was muted myself. So for the next case presentation, is my screen audible, right? Is my screen audible?
I'm you are sharing audible, ma'am. Your screen is not visible, ma'am.
Oh, okay. So
yes. Please share your screen.
Yes, yes, yes. Sharing the screen. So for the next second topic of today's webinar, we have a case presentation, postgraduate case presentation, as I said, tracheobronchial foreign body in children, which would be chaired by Dr. Sandeep Mishra, sir. He is the professor, Department of Anesthesiology Critical Care, JIPMER, Puducherry. Welcome, sir. He's the previous HOD of the Department of Anesthesiology at JIPMER between 2017-19. And his areas of interest include pediatric airway, intensive care, and thoracic anesthesia. Very warm welcome to you, sir. It is his PG who would be presenting today. And for the second chairperson, I would like to invite our Dr. Nibadita Panni, madam. She's a professor in HOD of Department of Anesthesiology Critical Care, SCB Cuttack. Her achievements are numerous with various awards like the R.K. Sethi Award, the best performing national training for LSAS. She's received the second prize at RSSCPCon 2019. She's got the Professor G.C. Mitra Memorial Oration Award, IMA MMS HQ Chairman's Appreciation Award. Apart from numerous awards, I would take my time to state each and every one of them. And now she's presently the President IMA Odisha. A very active person involved in training of for in the COVID situation. And she's got numerous publications in various reputed journals. And her areas of interest include pediatric anesthesia, ICU and critical care, and pain. So welcome, warm welcome to you, madam. And over to you, both of you, for the case presentation now. I'll stop sharing my screen now.
Thank you, Bijalakshmi. Such a wonderful words of yours. I can't express my feelings. First of all, let me give a regards to all my seniors. And I must thank our president, Dr. Indrani ma'am, and our main person behind this is Naveen sir. And Vijaya Lakshmi, who have allowed me to speak in this platform. Thank you very much, Vijaya. And this topic which you have given is a really interesting topic. And when this topic generally comes when these cases specially come, it is really a challenging for the all the anesthesiologists. As you know that this tracheobronchial foreign body is an emergency situation and is a life-threatening situation. And mainly it occurs in the pediatric population. And it is very much essential. We have to early the diagnosis and successful removal of the things has to be done. And if you go back to the history, you'll be astonished that Gustav Kellian is the first to use the rigid bronchoscope to remove a foreign body from the right main bronchus. History started from there. Now you see the history has landed with a fiber optic in the 1970. And where you can see how we are so nicely doing and helping the and making the lives also, like so a lot of lives we are able to survive. You see, when a foreign body patient comes, it is really a distressing, really distressing. It's both for the anesthesiologist, patient, mother, and here the when the baby comes, you know that the emotional works. So that's put a lot of pressure. So I hope today's discussion will be definitely helpful for the postgraduate students. Thank you, Vijayalakshmi. And now I request Sandeep to take over. I hope Sandeep will take over now. Thank you, Vijaya.
Thank you, madam. Thank you, Dr. Vijayalakshmi and the whole RSCP team. Without delay, I think we can start because it's already, I think, 7:30. Okay, at least half an hour, huh? Please give us.
Okay. Yes, sir. You so, can introduce your PG, sir.
Yeah. And before that, I will tell that the main intention of this case presentation is many of the working anesthesiologists still not got the opportunity to do a few numbers of tracheobronchial foreign body. And it's a very tricky situation when you take these patients both in semi-emergency and emergency condition. And it's not only will help the postgraduates, also any audience who wants to continue its learning, it's going to help. Here we are going to present in briefly postgraduate Dr. Emaya T. She's going to present for a few minutes about the case, followed by we'll proceed how to proceed for the preoperative evaluation to optimizations and the OT preparations. Okay, and this is very, very important, and this is a pediatric CRO. Then this foreign body, where it is located and its presentations, how it's going to behave, then whether it is semi-emergency and emergency, then knowing the ventilation technique, which basically a pediatric ventilating rigid bronchoscope, understanding the pediatric rigid ventilating bronchoscope and how to ventilate through it. And the close communications between the endoscopists, who are the basically surgeons most of the times, which includes ENT or CT-based pediatric surgeons, along with the anesthesiologist, and the overall managements, how to do it. So with this, Dr. Emaya is going to in briefly present. I am requesting Dr. Vijayalakshmi to kindly allow her to share the slides.
Yes, sir. She's been made co-host already. Okay, she can present.
Dr. Emaya?
Yes, sir.
Yes, she is final year postgraduates going to appear in December coming year, this year. You can start, Emaya, with your slides, okay?
Good evening, everyone. Now I'm going to present a case about tracheobronchial foreign body in a child. So a 2-year-old male child was brought by...
Is it audible to all?
The volume is less. Please keep the mic close to your mouth, Dr. Emaya.
Yes. A 2-year-old male child was brought by his mother from Kadalur, which is 30 kilometers away from Jipmer, and the informant's reliability was good. So the child was presented with the chief complaints of history of choking, which was observed while eating peanuts, followed by bouts of violent coughing since morning. And regarding the history of presenting illness, there was history of choking while eating peanuts around 8 hours back, and then violent coughing has started. And there is also...
Dr. Emaya, sorry to interrupt you. You need to start the PPT, please. Yes, please. Please continue.
Yes, sir. And regarding the history of presenting illness, there is history of choking while eating peanuts around 8 hours back, and then followed by violent coughing. There is also associated with noisy breathing and difficulty in breathing since that episode. and there is no history of drooling of saliva or difficulty in swallowing. And there is no history of fever or nasal discharge, and there is no history of loss of consciousness or seizures, no history of bluish discoloration of the skin, and there is no history of trauma or hemoptysis, and no history of failure to thrive or snoring. And regarding the past history, there is no previous history of surgery or hospitalization. Mother does not give any allergy to drug or food items, and there is no history of bronchial asthma or pneumonia, and there is no contact with tuberculosis patient, and there is no history of recurrent respiratory tract infection. And regarding the antenatal history, all trimesters were uneventful, and the child was a term normal vaginal delivery, and the birth weight was 2.7 kg, and the child cried immediately after birth, and there is no history of NICU admission. In developmental history, baby attained all milestones which is appropriate for the age, and it is immunized up to date. And regarding the summary, a 2-year-old child with history of choking while eating, followed by difficulty in breathing, associated with noisy breathing and respiratory distress, could be a probable foreign body in the bronchus. And probable system involved here is respiratory system. I would like to go ahead with the examination. And regarding general examination, the child is irritable and crying, and pulse rate is 120 beats per minute, which is regular in rhythm, and blood pressure is 90 over 60, which was measured in left arm in sitting position, and respiratory rate is 44 per minute, associated with subcostal retraction and nasal flaring, and the child is afebrile, and hydration status is adequate, and room air saturation being 90%. And there is no pallor, icterus, cyanosis, clubbing, lymphedema or lymphadenopathy or pedal edema. And the height of the child is 83 centimeters and weight is 12 kgs. And regarding the airway examination, no syndromic feces were noted and flaring of nasal alveoli is present. No retronathia or micronathia noticed. No gross craniofacial anomalies present. And on inspection of respiratory system, trachea seems to be in the midline and tracheal tug was present. No scar, sinuses or dilated veins noted. No crowding of ribs or chest wall deformity present. And chest movement was decreased on the right side. And on palpation, trachea was felt in the midline and chest expansion was asymmetrical and decreased on the right side. No tenderness was noticed and no friction femoris, and chest circumference was 46 centimeters and right hemithorax was 24 centimeters and left hemithorax was 22 centimeters. And on percussion, except for the inframammary and infraaxillary region on the right side, which was hyperresonant on percussion.
Can you move your slides?
Yes, sir.
The sides are not moving. This is remaining static with history of present inlet.
Is it visible now, ma'am?
Yeah, just keep it in the X-ray findings. That is more, that table, you just focus on that.
Okay, ma'am. And regarding percussion, except for the inframammary and infraaxillary region on the right side, which was hyperresonant on percussion, others were normal. And on auscultations, right inframammary and infraaxillary region was showing decreased breath sounds, and other regions were normal, vesicular breath sounds were heard. Another systemic examination on cardiovascular system, heart sounds 1 and 2 were heard and no additional sounds were heard. And on CNS, central nervous system, no focal neurological deficit noticed. And on per abdominal, it was soft and non-tender. So the probable diagnosis is a 2-year-old child who was developmentally normal with no comorbidities with signs of respiratory distress following foreign body aspiration was suspected to be a peanut. It just probably lodged in the right mainstem bronchus. And I would like to go ahead with investigations to confirm my diagnosis.
Your slides are still not moving, actually. So
please put it on presentation
yes,
mode.
Just press this, yeah. Press this key, Dr. Emiya, please press.
Yes, sir.
Press it, please.
Still not.
The button which is close to the 77% on the right side. Yes, this one, please press it.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I'm done with the slides, sir. I'll move into the chest X-ray findings and investigation.
It doesn't matter whichever slide you read. Please just highlight that slide, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, please move on.
And regarding the investigations,
I will just interrupt and ask you a question. Okay. Why history of any unconsciousness or seizure is important in this situation?
Sir, any tracheobronchial foreign body can cause airway obstruction, sir. So this airway obstruction can cause hypoxia, sir. Then this hypoxia can trigger seizures and loss of consciousness in a child, sir.
Okay, so how the presentations can be if child is already a seizures, one or two episodes?
Yes, sir. And the temporal association could be there, sir. Followed by foreign body ingestion, there could be a temporal association between seizures, sir.
Okay, anything else specific which is important for perioperative management?
Sir, we have to, in post-operative situations, this anti-seizure medications and in the preoperative times?
No, I'm talking about when patients is unconscious after seizure activity, unconscious or altered sensorium because of seizure. That's what you told because of hypoxia.
Yes,
very high chance patients, child may aspirate the stomach content inside the lung. Okay.
Yes,
so they will present with a very bad lungs compared to the straightforward ingestion of the foreign body. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So aspiration of the stomach content can be there. Okay. That's one of the important point. Okay.
Yes,
fine. So what are the further investigations you want to do?
Sir, I would like to go ahead with the chest
X-ray. This patient is posted for next day operation theater. Okay. As a semi-elective case. Okay.
Okay, sir.
So what further evaluations you want to do?
Sir, I would like to go ahead with the chest X-ray and X-ray next, sir.
Okay. Why you need it?
Sir, here in chest X-ray, I would like to confirm where is the location of the foreign body, sir, in this patient. And if some foreign bodies can be radio opaque also, sir. So those can be picked up, sir. The location can be picked up. And some cases, there could be complication followed by foreign body inhalation, sir. Like pneumonia, abscess, and atelectasis, which could be picked up by
the... Okay. So what are the different common foreign body encounter in pediatric patients? Yes, ma'am.
Sandeep, can I ask her a question here in the foreign
ma'am,
body?
Sure, ma'am. Please.
Yes. What are the types of foreign body generally we come across in a pediatric patient?
Ma'am, almost like 95% to 97% of foreign bodies are basically organic foreign bodies, ma'am. So
yes, another one is organic. Second is
inorganic or foreign bodies, ma'am.
Can say metallic. One is organic.
Yes, ma'am.
One second is metallic, and third is
rubber or wood, ma'am. Miscellaneous.
Yeah. So organic groups is which one?
Ma'am, these can be peanuts.
Your patient belongs to which group?
Organic group, ma'am.
Yes, organic group.
Yes.
So generally, why this children always at risk? What for?
Ma'am, usually the age group between 1 to 3 years are at more risk, ma'am, because this age group tends to have oral exploration of their environment, ma'am. So they tend to, and during that time only the pincer grip also develops in these patients, ma'am. So they tend to put up everything they come across into their mouth, and they don't have molar tooth also, ma'am. So they cannot chew.
Yes, correct. There is lack of molar tooth to crush.
Yes.
Second is incomplete coordination of the mouth and tongue.
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
And third is one most important is that they have got an immature glottis reflex. That's whatever it got, immediately it got. Okay? Am I clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Sandeep, now you can take over.
Yes, ma'am. Okay. So what are the common organic foreign body? In your case, it is peanuts. What other common for organic foreign body and why it's important?
Other foreign bodies can be beans, sir. Beans, grapes,
okay.
And beans. They're mostly like sapota seeds or custard apple seeds. These are
okay.
Encountered in our setup, sir. Peas can also be.
Okay. Heard. Any foreign body which can cause chemical reaction, granuloma, and all this, okay, with a more chance.
Betel nut can cause highly.
Okay, so betel nuts, which is commonly available, huh? Okay, in many northern part of India. Okay.
Yes, sir.
It can cause. Now, what about sapota seeds?
Sapota seeds, these are highly hygroscopic, sir. So they can
yes.
Absorb water and they
so
can.
Very high chance it may cause obstruction of the trachea. Okay, maybe partial or sometime rarely complete. Okay.
Yes, sir.
And it's also rarely center the bronchus, but more so in trachea, which is more challenging sometimes. Okay, than a bronchial foreign body. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. So in chest X-ray, what you are going to see? Other overall. As you told?
Usually within 24 hours of presentation, sir, in case of any organic foreign body, the changes might not be visible in chest X-ray, sir. So, but other confounding findings can be elicited in these patients, sir? For example, because of there are many types of obstruction, sir, like
what are the different types of obstruction?
Sir, there are like almost four types of obstruction, sir. The one could be a stop valve effect, and the second could be a check valve or a ball valve or a bypass valve, sir. So depending.
Okay, just describe in brief each.
Sandeep, can I interfere?
Sure, ma'am.
Okay, which one is most troublesome for the anesthesiologist?
Complete obstruction in the proximal airway, ma'am.
Okay.
Stop valve.
Why? That is a stop valve. Why?
Because ventilation is completely affected, ma'am. In other bypass mechanisms, there will be ingress of air as well as egress of air and oxygen, ma'am. But in this case, no
so
air.
So actually, in the stop valve, what happened? There is no way. Both in and out of the air collapse of the lungs occurs.
Yes,
okay.
Ma'am.
Can you explain what happened in the one way?
In one way valve, ma'am, there are actually two types, ma'am, check valve as well as ball valve effect, ma'am. In case of check valve effect, inspiration is unaffected, ma'am, but expiration, there occurs an obstruction, ma'am. So this causes air trapping and dynamic hyperinflation of the lungs, ma'am, with each breath. So that can cause ruptured and barotrauma, volutrauma, leading to pneumothorax as well as pneumomediastinum in these patients. Emphysematous changes sets in, ma'am, in this case. And in ball valve effect, there will be inspiration is affected, ma'am, but expiration is not affected, ma'am. So this will cause passive emptying of the lungs and followed by collapse and atelectasis of the lungs, ma'am.
Clinically, you have said that your this foreign body has gone to right bronchus.
Yes,
I'll ask you one question. Why this right bronchus is more common? What is the reason behind it?
Ma'am, actually, in pediatric age groups, ma'am, that carinal angle is almost equal in both sides, ma'am. So it can cause enlargement in the right as well as left, ma'am. But in cases of adults, as a child grows, the right bronchus is more in line with the trachea, ma'am. And it is broader when compared to that of left side, ma'am, left bronchus, ma'am. So usually, right-sided foreign bodies are common in this.
And there is also large diameter also, okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Sandeep, to you, over.
Thank you, ma'am. Okay. So how we are going to plan it for preoperative evaluation, any other further evaluation if anything you need, and how what's your plan for preoperative optimizations and the instruction?
Yes, sir. Regarding pre-op optimization, sir, since this patient's room air saturation is 90% and there is a tachypnea in this child, I would like to start the patient on oxygen therapy, sir. So I would like to put the patient on Hudson's face mask. And since it is an organic foreign body which was inhaled, I would like to start the patient on dexamethasone, sir, to prevent airway edema, because these organic foreign bodies can trigger intense inflammatory reactions. So I would like to put the child according to the body weight. I would like to put the child on 3 mg of dexamethasone, sir, every 8 hourly. And bronchodilator nebulizations like salbutamol, 2.5 mg. Over a period of 15 minutes, every 6th hourly, I will give, sir. And antibiotics, in our institute, we will put a patient on broad spectrum antibiotics like ceftriaxone, 600 mg, I would like to start, sir. And before taking up the patient to the theater, I would like to get a written informed consent from the mother, and I would like to pre-medicate the child, sir. I will advise her according to the standard ASA fasting guidelines. And I will also pre-medicate the child with steroids and glycopyrrolate according to the anti-sialagogue dose, which is 5 mics per kg. I would like to...
Any role of hydration?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. According to ASA's fasting status, 2 hours prior to the surgery, clear fluids like water or sugar water, I'll allow, sir. If required, I'll supplement the child with IV hydration also, sir, in this child. According to Holliday-Seegers formula, body weight, approximately 45 to 50 ml per hour, I'll give maintenance fluids in this.
Okay, this patient's already IV access is there, okay? 120 gauge IV cannula is there, because they have given antibiotics and dexamethasone, okay? And this patient is going to, we are going to take as a first case in the operation theater, okay, at 8 o'clock, morning 8 a.m. Okay, so how we are going ahead and how we are going to prepare your operation theater?
Morning before shifting to the OT, I would like to give a shot of steroids as well as glycopyrrolate. I will try to avoid sedative pre-medications in this child, sir. And before shifting to OT. I'll prepare the OT, sir. I'll check the anesthesia machine and I'll keep the resuscitation equipments ready. And I'll also arrange for ASA standard 2 monitors like pulse oximeter, ECG, and non-invasive blood pressure monitoring and capnography. And I'll also arrange an airway cart. And I'll prepare general anesthesia drugs and emergency drugs like adrenaline with serial dilutions. General anesthesia drugs I'll prepare according to the body weight and appropriate dilution. And I also, regarding the airway cut, I will keep all the airway equipments ready in this patient and will also maintain an optimum ambient OT temperature. And I prior to shifting the patient, I will also check my pediatric
brain. Okay, about the airway equipments, what are you going to keep it? Specific to this case,
yes, sir. Airway cart, sir. I'll arrange for appropriate size laryngoscopic blades, sir, and the endotracheal tubes of appropriate size plus or minus one tube will be. For example, in this trial, if I'm going to plan ahead with 4.5, I'll keep smaller size tubes also ready in this patient. And airway adjuncts like oropharyngeal and nasopharyngeal airway, Meggel's forceps, bougie and stilettes, and pediatric breathing circuits like JRM ATP, Jackson's Rees modification of OSTPs, and suction also I'll keep ready, sir. And
what about face masks?
Yes, sir. Anatomical face masks, appropriate size, tight fitting also keep ready, sir. And provision for nebulization and lignocaine spray and extra oxygen O2 supply.
Sandeep, can I interfere?
Sure, sure, ma'am.
Dear doctor, can you tell me, suppose you require a rigid bronchoscope, which size for this patient you will keep?
Ma'am,
how you calculate the size of the arch for the AS, how much size you have to keep? Can you tell me?
Yes, ma'am. Actually, there are multiple sizes available, ma'am. In our institute, we are using Karl Strauss rigid ventilating bronchoscope, ma'am. It comes in various sizes from 2.5 to 6.5, ma'am, with increments of 0.5 sizes, ma'am. And internal, based on internal and external diameter is also there, ma'am. For example, in this child, the child belongs to 2 years, ma'am. So in this case, I would like to go ahead with the 4 size, ma'am. 4 size, and this has an internal diameter of 6 and external diameter of 6.7, ma'am. So I would like to go ahead with this, ma'am.
Okay, good.
Yes, ma'am. I'm just sharing one slide, okay.
Yes.
You have to tell about details about the rigid ventilating bronchoscopes. Okay, parts. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Just one.
Maya, you have to stop sharing your slide so that.
Yes,
then I able to share. Then I able to share, Dr. Bijayarashmi.
Not yet, sir.
Okay, just one. I will wait for a few seconds.
Anyway, we can in between the slide is there. We can ask question to her also. Is it okay, Sandeep?
Yes, yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Ma'am, actually, the rigid ventilating bronchoscopes you tell next. So I thought little parts she has to tell. So I thought I'll show some few slides.
No, you can ask her the parts, no problem. She can tell. What are the parts?
Ma'am, Dr. Bade sir has asked a question in the chat box, ma'am. Go ahead with that, ma'am.
Yeah.
What is the name of the bronchoscope, rigid bronchoscope? Have you got any idea?
Sorry, ma'am?
What is the name of this rigid bronchoscope?
What is the role of CT and virtual bronchoscopy in patient? That's what, no, ma'am?
Yes.
No, ma'am. No. I wanted the name. What is the name of
it? Yes, ma'am. Please.
When it was invented, it was based on Meggel's, ma'am. Meggel's had first used a rigid bronchoscope, ma'am. So first it was called historically Meggel's bronchoscope, ma'am. And now
you mean also stop.
Sorry, ma'am. Hello, ma'am.
Yeah. Unmute yourself, madam.
Hello, ma'am.
Nibetita, madam, unmute yourself.
Muted.
Sandeep, sir, you can go ahead by the time she sorts out with her audio.
Yeah, can you allow me?
Yes, sir, you can share already your co-host. So.
Sandeep, you can ask one by one before sewing. What are the parts? You can ask.
Just one minute.
Please share, sir, your screen. Not yet visible. Yes, sir, visible. Your screen is visible.
Okay. So, just can you let me know the different parts of the rigid ventilating bronchoscope?
Yes, sir.
This is what, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5? Yes.
Number one is a standard 15mm connector for a breathing circuit, sir, preferably JRM ATP in this case, sir. And the number is jet ventilation port, sir, where we can provide for jet ventilation in this case. And three would be the instrumentation port for the endoscopist, where they can use forceps or suction in this patient, sir, and for retrieving of the foreign body. And four would be for the connection of prism or a light source cable, sir. And then five, it could be the ventilating slots, sir. Usually three in the terminal end, there will be three ventilating slots available, sir.
Okay.
So, ventilating slots, sir.
What is the role of these slots? Why it is there?
Sir, this actually inside the glottis, it behaves like an endotracheal tube, sir. And after that, once when we are retrieving a foreign body from a side of bronchus, the contralateral lung could also be ventilated with this ventilating slots, sir. While manipulating in the right bronchus, if you want to ventilate the left bronchus, this will serve the purpose, sir.
Yeah, so actually, it depends upon the how much length inside the bronchus. Okay, and we'll able to ventilate the contralateral lung. So if the one of the parts, most of the time it will be there, okay, for a brief period at least, to ventilate the contralateral lung. Okay, second is sometime the bronchoscope may is the wall of the trachea, okay, in lumen, okay, that point of time also it's helping ventilation. And what's more important is sometimes these slots or what is called fenestration also, when we are entering just below the glottis, it may be outside and we should not start ventilating, okay? So all the slots has to be below the glottis, okay? And communication between the endoscopist, who is the surgeon most of the time, and the anesthesiologist is very, very important.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Number six.
Sir, hello?
Is it audible? Hello?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Audible now, sir.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Audible, sir.
6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
Six will be the adapter for light source, sir. And seven will be called as the Fluox adapter, sir. In Karl Storz model, it is called a Fluox sliding scale adapter, sir. And eight will be the bridge connector, sir, with this the Hopkins rod, sir. And nine will be the suction, sir, suction adapter. And 10 will be the suction leak. There should not be any leak during ventilation, sir. For that, we have a rubber cap, rubber seal, sir, to prevent leak.
Okay. So all of us should be, when we are learning, all of us should be aware of the all the parts, because any point of time, any interventions, we have to know, because patient may be underventilated or we are not able to ventilate in case any changes are there. So better coordination between surgeons and anesthesiologists throughout the intervention, we should do it. Now, what is this? What is this forceps?
Sir, it is
an
alligator crocodile forceps, sir. It's grasping forceps, sir, in 11th.
Okay.
With which we can retrieve the foreign bodies.
Forceps are... They are perfectly okay, so they have to keep it ready well before. Then can you explain again number 12, this one?
Yes, sir.
These three parts, yes.
Yes, sir. This is a Fluox sliding scale adapter, sir. The left one will be the glass obturator, sir. So once we close this, we'll be able to ventilate the patient, sir. And during instrumentation, the middle one will give us the air seal, sir. Airlock seal will be there. With that also we can ventilate. And the third one, sir, will be the lateral one will be during for like retrieving of foreign body and for instrumentation. That time will be open, sir. That time it will be difficult to ventilate the patient with the breathing circuit, sir.
Okay. Okay, so with this you can see the current lesson here in middle of the jet. Okay, practicing. Okay, many of not practice nowadays. Those who are not used to this and common sports ventilation or spontaneous paralyzing with a JRM ATPs, ATPs use Jackson remodification iris TPs. So you can see here connect and this is the port for this. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Can you tell this device?
Sir, this about? Is an automated yes. jet ventilator, sir. Automated jet.
Okay. Ventilator. Okay. So this was basically initially was used for a transport sorts of ventilator, but it's used for more than 3 to 4 decades in our institutes. With a time, can you describe it if you know?
Sir, basically, automated jet ventilator is a pneumatic high pressure driven ventilator, sir. So it runs in 50 psi pressure, sir, and it has a power on and off switch, and it has 3 control knobs, sir. One is for setting the inspiratory flow, and the second is for inspiratory time, and the next one being the expiratory time, sir. It will be connected to the via a jet ventilation cannula, non-complete cannula. It could be connected to the jet ventilation port of the rigid ventilating bronchoscope, and it can be used, sir. We can automatically it sets the.
Fine. So how we are going to choose a cannula? What size? In case you are using this type of device.
Sir, many color coded cannulas are there according to the age group, sir, and we can conventionally we can measure the size of the ventilation jet ventilation port, and with that measurement we can insert inside the ventilation slot, sir.
Yes, but that's fine for the other devices. It's called Menujet. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay, this most of the times a particularly epidural blunted epidural cannula, okay, which is used for epidural needle, okay.
Yes, sir.
That can be used between 16 to up to 22. Okay, or IM needle also blunted can be used. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Fine, but you have made you should make sure that all these adjustments should be there before and okay,
yes,
and not at the last moment. Okay, if you are planning for a jet ventilation. Okay.
Okay. Yes, sir.
So this is a overall parts of a automated jet ventilation. Okay.
Okay.
And as you told, okay, it's a 3 knobs, okay, and you can use induction with inhalation or intravenous, but you have to maintain with the intravenous anesthetic agents. You cannot maintain easily with the inhalation anesthetic agents. There's the drawbacks, but there's the advantage also, because throughout operation you will maintain the depth of the anesthesia because you are using intravenous anesthetic agents. Okay, fine. So how we are going to proceed?
Sir, I would like to go ahead with the general anesthesia with the sevoflurane induction and the supplementation with propofol if required, maintaining spontaneous ventilation, sir, in this patient.
Okay, so how? Tell me the steps which you are going to follow.
Yes, sir. After preparing the OT with the appropriate equipments and everything, so I
yes, fine.
NPO status of the child and
I'll yeah, all prepared. You have connected the monitor as you told. Okay.
Yes,
and you can prepare also temperature probe, though it's usually take less times and maintain the operation theater temperature accordingly. Okay. If it's available option. Okay. Until now, what's you're going to do next?
Sir, as soon as I'm done attaching the monitors, I'll connect a IV drip set or a burette set, sir, or a dial flow to give IV hydration to the child. And I will start with the graded sevoflurane induction, sir, inhalation and induction with 100% oxygen, sir, with appropriate
okay.
face mask, sir, tight fitting face
fine.
Mask.
Fine, next.
And after that, I will start with the 25 micrograms of fentanyl IV. And if required, I'll assist the ventilation and deepen the plane, sir. Once the child is deep enough, I will start a gentle laryngoscopy and see the.
So, intravenous, what you gave? Other,
fentanyl,
you started
sir.
IV fentanyl. Fluids, okay.
Yes,
fentanyl, okay. Fine.
IV followed by fentanyl.
Okay.
And after that, I'll deepen the plane and I'll do a gentle laryngoscopy and I'll check for foreign body and I'll check.
So when you are going to do gentle laryngoscopy, what about your depth of anesthesia?
The child should be under sir. It should be deep. The child should be deep, sir. There should be no movement to jaw thrust and.
Plane. Okay, I will know the depth of anesthesia.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, breathing pattern, sir, and
okay.
of the child, and response to the jaw thrust, jaw relaxation.
Okay. Anything monitor you can see?
Monitoring, sir, we can use other setups. We can use depth of anesthesia monitoring also, sir.
No, fine. You have Mac, no?
Yes, sir. Mac, we can go ahead. Mac.
Okay, you can maintain. Yes, fine. Okay, yes. Next, what we are going to do?
Sir, in that, after doing a gentle laryngoscopy by the endoscopist or the ENT surgeon, they'll usually check for the foreign body inside the oral cavity or any lodged inside the piriform sinus or valleculus, sir.
Okay, so it's better to inspect the oral cavity. Okay, fine.
Next. Foreign bodies can be present at times.
Fine. Yes. Next.
And next, we have to anesthetize the glottis, sir. So here I would like to go ahead with the 1% to 4 ml of lignocaine, sir. I'll spray the glottis and then I will come out and I'll do gentle ventilation, sir, to allow for the action of the spray. And I'll also deepen the plane again, sir, for insertion of the rigid ventilating bronchoscope. Meanwhile, be in constant close communication with the endoscopist and other
anesthesiologists.
Around, sir. The anesthesia team should be always in a close communication loop in this situation.
Fine. Next, what we're going to do?
Then I have to give proper positioning for rigid bronchoscopy, sir. And this
case,
we'll start with the extension. Extension is paramount. So wedge and neck rolls and shoulder wedges can be kept to give a proper positioning, sir, for rigid bronchoscopy by help of assistant, sir, another assistant. And before entering the glottis, after adequate anesthetization, we can enter the glottis with appropriate size rigid bronchoscope. Now it acts like an enclosure tube. And now we can check for air entry, sir. So air entry should be checked constantly by a same person. And chest rise should be there as it was during the pre-operative period, sir.
Okay. So once inside the below the glottis, okay, inside the trachea, what you are going to do at point of time?
Sir, first I would like to maintain a patent airway in this patient and so at the same time ensure proper oxygenation and ventilation in this patient, sir. And we have to simultaneously blunt the airway reflexes also, sir, since I'm maintaining spontaneous ventilation.
That's fine. So what when it's inside the glottis, what again you are going to do? You are going to auscultate both the lungs again?
Yes, sir. I'll auscultate both the lungs, sir.
Yeah, that's the most important part. Okay. Every bit to bit, you have to inspect and auscultate and with a good coordination with the surgeon. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Fine. So it should be like what the same breath sounds, what you were hearing before should be there most of the times. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Okay, fine. Okay. Yes. Next, what's going to do surgeon? It's once it is inside the trachea. This is one of the most important part where you should make sure that ventilation should be adequate because any point of time, any problem occur, you have to come to the trachea first. Okay. Next is you have to take out the bronchoscope out and mass ventilate. So this phase is very, very important and you should spend some 30 seconds to 1 minute time and make sure that ventilation, both the lungs as it was there before, should be there. Okay. Next, what you are going to do? My surgeons along with.
Sir, now it will be, they will go into the concerned trachea and they will use the telescope.
Okay, so remember, most of the time surgeons lubricate the bronchoscope. Okay,
yes.
They also infiltrate, okay, local anesthetics, okay, when they go inside also, okay,
yes, sir.
Which is also anesthetized part of the trachea and the carina. Okay. Next.
Via the instrumentation port, they can insert a telescope and they'll check for the location of the foreign body. And after that, with the
grasping focus. So during it is there, suppose it is in right bronchocyte in your case. Okay.
Yes,
how you are going to ventilate the other lungs? Okay. And how you are going to manage during that period of time? They may do repeated instrumentation, depends upon the location of the foreign body, types of foreign body. Okay. And duration of foreign body. Okay.
Yes, sir. Sir, most of the times the side penetration ventilating slots can ventilate the contralateral side, sir.
Okay. Okay. In case not, what you are going to do? Suppose both the penetration are inside the bronchus. Okay.
Yes, sir. If there is any desaturation or hypoxia, we have to come to the
trachea. Yes, you have a very limited time frame. Okay. Okay, so any point of time desaturation, anticipating it, so you have to go to come to the trachea and again they will try. Okay, but you have to allow the surgeon sufficient time so that they can hold the foreign body. Okay, through the with the help of Postscript. Okay, next.
Sir, once they retrieve the foreign body, sir, and after that, everything, the forceps along with the foreign body and the rigid ventilating bronchoscope will be taken as a single unit, sir. So that time,
yes. Okay. Yes, sir. So what we'll do that time? What precautions we will take?
Proper positioning should be given, and the patient should not cough or buck, sir. So because
dislocation. So we should stabilize the head, particularly neck. Okay. Hmm? And open the mouth also when they are retrieving it. Okay. Hmm? Yes. Because all three has to come out in situ. Okay.
Yes.
All three. Okay.
Yes.
Fine. So what are the problems can occur while retrieving a foreign body from a bronchus to trachea? What problems can occur? Accidental.
Sir, accidental dislodgement will be there, sir, and there can be fragmentation, okay. Sir. Especially organic foreign bodies are very friable, and they can be.
Okay. So it can be inside the trachea or the contralateral lungs also. Okay, not only, huh? Okay, fine. Okay, so now foreign body is out. Okay, huh? They retrieve the foreign body. Okay, now what you will do next?
Sir, after that also we have to mask.
In your case.
Yes, sir. After that, I will mask ventilate the patient and maintain depth of appropriate depth of anesthesia with sevoflurane, sir. Then again, I will do gentle laryngoscopy and check for any airway edema, sir, glottic edema especially, because of repeated instrumentation will be there. So if there is no significant glottic edema, we can come down on the depth and we can do chest physiotherapy, and we can maintain spontaneous ventilation in this patient, and followed by post removal of foreign body, we can give nebulization to this patient, like adrenaline and salbutamol in this patient, sir. If significant airway edema or glottic edema is present, I would multiple instrumentation or any airway trauma with associated bleeding is there, I will go ahead with intubating this patient, sir. And elective post of mechanical ventilation will be there, and that time I'll do chest physiotherapy and other bronchodilators and antibiotics and steroid cut. After that, I will extubate the patient, sir.
Okay, so most of the times.
Can I interview you?
Yes, ma'am. Please, ma'am.
Why during a maneuver, why excess suction is not allowed? You should not do excess suction. Why?
Ma'am, excess suction will cause atelectasis also, ma'am, because oxygen is also sucked in. So it will cause atelectasis also in this patient, ma'am. So hypoxia is again worsened in this patient due to exuberant suctioning, ma'am.
Okay. Right. Sandeep, you go ahead.
Yes, ma'am. Okay. So suppose in place of your case is 2 years child, okay? Hmm? Suppose this case, child is a larger child, okay, around 7 to 8 years.
Okay.
And the bronchoscope used, okay, there is a leak around the glottis, okay, and because the size is smaller, okay, and that's what available size, because it's not always fit to the approximate size, like we have endotracheal tube all size from a 2.5 to, okay, all size up to 6-7 for repetitive size groups, okay, same thing is not there for rigid bronchoscope. So in this situation, how you are going to manage?
Sir, in this patient, I would go ahead with the jet ventilation in this patient, sir. Difficult to maintain.
Okay, so one option is jet ventilation if you are used to the technique, okay, or experienced with the technique, okay. Hmm? Okay, in spite of that, some amount of leak will be there, but very minimal with that. Any other option with a spontaneous with GRM ATP circuit? So in this situation, while moving the bronchoscope from glottis then to trachea, okay,
yes,
okay, there will be leak, so you have to apply at laryngeal pressure, gentle laryngeal pressure, it will most of the time it will occlude and you will able to ventilate. Then once they will go to bronchus again, so you have to do same procedure, okay. This takes hardly 1 to 2 minutes, you have to obstruct it and you will able to ventilate. Minimal leak will be there, or there will be no leak also. So this external laryngeal maneuver is there for your laryngoscopy, same external laryngeal maneuver can be done. Okay. Keeping in mind, you should not apply too much pressure. Okay. Fine. So, what about if it's a tracheal foreign body?
So, tracheal foreign body is still more dangerous when compared to that of bronchial foreign body, sir. It was a total airway obstruction in this patient, sir. And we have very limited time frame in this patient, sir. So that because of the limited time frame, it is better to sometimes organic foreign bodies will cause the swelling up and cause total obstruction, sir. In this case, we have to try to remove the foreign body as soon as possible. If that is not possible, it is better to break the foreign body into small pieces and then remove it, sir. If that is also not an option, we can push the foreign body to any one of the bronchus intentionally, and then we can retrieve, sir, after adequate oxygenation.
Okay. So in a particular smaller child, okay, 6 months to 1 year, okay, which is slightly less common than 2 to 3 years, okay. Sometimes it is difficult to retrieve the foreign body, okay. So they may break it, but they may able to hold the grasp the foreign body, but they will not able to take out through the glottis, okay, because all has to come out in as a one unit, as you told, okay. So foreign body in trachea, and after grasping with the forceps, okay, it's not able to take out because the size is bigger than the bronchoscope.
Yes, sir.
Sometimes this particularly happened in a very small child, okay, with a like support seats or some seats which is very hygroscopy, and they'll swell.
Yes, sir.
In this situation, there are limited option. Either you have to break it, okay, in piecemeal, okay, and ventilation during that point of time is very, very crucial because high chance of desaturations, a good coordination required, okay, and you may have to interrupt intermittently, okay, if you are not using a jet. But if you are using a jet also, it's difficult for surgeons because it's interfere with their procedures while retrieving this, okay. Now what about your post-op plan, any other?
Malakoto.
Yes. Hello,
sorry sir.
Yeah, what about your post-op plan?
Sir, post-op plan, in case I had extubated the child, I will resume oral water intake after 4 hours, sir, and will also put the patient on steroids for post-operatively 3 days, sir, and I will continue the nebulization, sir, especially adrenaline and salbutamol also, and antibiotics also I will try to continue for a period of 3 to 5 days as necessary. And the chest physiotherapy is also very much important, sir. So chest physiotherapy will also cause drainage of the secretions and
Sandeep, okay. Can I interrupt you here?
Sure, ma'am.
What is the complication occurs during this procedure, can you tell me?
Complications can be first thing because of since the patient is in spontaneous mode, ma'am, so the depth might be like not adequate, ma'am, if you're totally following inhalational because of interrupted periods of ventilation. So the patient can cough or buck anytime during this procedure, and which can trigger bronchospasm, ma'am, or laryngospasm if at all. And other thing could be airway trauma, ma'am, because of rigid bronchoscopy and frequent manipulation that can cause airway trauma also, and arrhythmias because of the cardiac reflexes, cardiorespiratory reflexes, arrhythmias can also be there, and the child can aspirate or regurgitate in this situation.
Even sometimes cardiac arrest also can occur also, okay?
Yes, ma'am.
That is remote, even cardiac arrest also has occurred, okay?
Yes, ma'am. And even exuberant positive pressure ventilation can cause barotrauma and pneumothorax in this patient, ma'am. So,
and also pneumomediastinum can occur also.
Yes, ma'am. Okay. Pneumomediastinitis can also be possible.
Okay. So, you told about the post-op test strider sometimes also occurs. If there is strider, how are you going to manage?
Ma'am, again, I'll deepen the plane. I can supplement inhalational, IV induction agents, ma'am. Then I will give succinylcholine and I'll intubate the patient and I will electively ventilate this patient, ma'am.
Is there any role of nebulized epinephrine in it?
Yes, ma'am, it is there, ma'am. In case of
strider, nebulized epinephrine, 1 in 1,000.
Yes, ma'am.
0.5 ml per kg. So maximum you can go 5 ml per administration. Am I right?
Yes, ma'am.
So Sandeep, you go ahead.
Yeah. Now, what is the role of apneic oxygenation when you don't have a ventilating bronchoscope available?
Sir, in this situation, we'll mass ventilate the patient for 3 to 5 minutes, sir. So we'll cause intentional hypocapnia and then we'll cause denitrogenation also, sir, in this patient. So we'll ask them to go ahead with the rigid ventilating bronchoscope, sir. And we'll have a set threshold for, again, ventilating the patient in this situation, sir. For example, critical saturations will be around like 88 to 90% in this situation, sir. So whenever there is a desaturation, we will again ask them to come out, and we will again ventilate this patient, sir, in this situation. And passively, it can cause oxygen insufflation also, sir. But only oxygenation is guaranteed in this patient, sir. Hypercapnia is always a risk in this patient, sir. For every minute, for the first minute, there will be a carbon dioxide increase of up to 8 to 12 millimeters of mercury. And every subsequent minute, there will be a 3 to 5 millimeters of mercury increase in carbon dioxide, sir. So there will be a hypercapnia in this patient, sir. And it has a higher risk of desaturation.
Okay. What are the other interventions done for tracheobronchial foreign body if it is not, cannot be retrieved through a bronchoscope?
Sometimes, sir, this, especially with the organic foreign body, if it swells up and it is not able to be retrieved from glottis, we can do a tracheostomy also, sir. With that tracheostomy stoma, we can retrieve, sir.
Sometimes tracheostomy is very rare. Okay. Okay. Very, very rare requirement. Okay. Now we are talking about a metallic foreign body or a very thick foreign body which is dislodged and it's already granuloma formed.
Thoracotomy if indicated, sir. Thoracotomy or
thoracoscopy and thoracotomy are sometimes required, more so in adult patients. Okay. Yes, or unconscious patient which is predated. Okay. Rare in predated age groups. Only few cases we have not seen, very rare it's in predated age groups.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Now, now coming to one more instrument which is not discussed here, which is Manojet, okay, which is, okay, Manojet, which is commonly available now, based last 5 to 10 years, okay. How you are going to utilize use it? Can you describe it?
Sir, Manojet is the latest development from Sanders Jet and automated jet, sir. So it is also basically powered by a pneumatic source of high pressure oxygen, preferably a 50 psi, sir. So it is also color coded, sir. Based on the pressures used for ventilation, it can be color coded. It has a 4 meters of connecting hose to the pipeline or the cylinder supply, sir. And we have a gauge to measure the pressure, and we have a handle or the knob to adjust the pressures at which we are going to ventilate the patient. There is a louver lock with a non-compliant jet ventilation cannula, sir. It can be provided by the manufacturer, or sometimes the blunted epidural tips and cannulas can also be used in this patient, sir. So it is basically based on.
Okay. Fine. So what are the advantages of jet over JRM-ATP?
Sir, jet ventilation, even when the when they are in the process of retrieving the foreign body, that time it will be difficult to maintain spontaneous ventilation, sir. So in those situations, when they are retrieving the foreign body, when there is so much of leak, we can actually give jet ventilation in this patient, sir.
Okay, so what additional things you have to do which is not required in a spontaneous? Yes.
Inhalational, sir. So TIVA we have to supplement, sir, totally intravenous.
So you have to give intravenous anesthetic agents like ketamine or propofol. Okay.
Yes.
So there are limitations.
Can I interfere here?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Why nitrous oxide is not given?
Ma'am, there is one check valve mechanism will cause hyperinflation, ma'am. Air trapping is also present, ma'am. So one thing is limited time frame for manipulation, ma'am. So they are at risk of desaturation. If you are using nitrous, we are not able to give 100% FiO2, ma'am. So that is one cause. So the safe apnea time is also reduced, ma'am. So the second thing being, there is a check valve mechanism in place. There will be active air trapping and dynamic hyperinflation. And so nitrous can exacerbate this condition and it will cause barotrauma again, and pneumothorax or pneumomediastinum can also happen.
How much you should leave for the apneic oxygenation time?
That depends on the patient, ma'am. Compared to adults, like infants are at high risk of desaturation, ma'am. So the duration of apnea, it's very less, ma'am. For example, in adults, the normal oxygen consumption will be at least 3.5 ml per kg per minute, ma'am. But in infants and pediatric age group, it is higher, ma'am, 4 to 6 ml per kg per minute, ma'am. So their basal metabolic rate compared to that of FRC is also very high, ma'am. So their oxygen stores are less, ma'am. So they have very less safe apnea time compared to that of adults, ma'am. So they are at risk of desaturation very soon, ma'am, compared to that. 3 to 5 minutes only, ma'am. In adults, it is 7 to 8 minutes. Here, it is only 3 to 5 minutes.
Even also 1 minute also, sometimes also, it can also create problems also, small baby also. Yeah. Okay, over to you, Sandeep.
Yes. Yes, ma'am. Any other questions from audience? We can start discussion, if it's okay.
If Vijayalakshmi permits and the time
yes,
is...
Sir. Yes, sir. I think a couple of questions are there. Bade sir has asked one question. This role of CT and virtual bronchoscopy in patient with foreign body of trachobronchial tree.
Okay. What is the role of CT and virtual bronchoscopy, Imaya?
Sir, CT, in emergency cases, sometimes it might not be able to take a CT, sir. For example, in some cases where CTs can be indicated as a stable patient or when there is any doubtful history of any foreign body conduction.
Yes, when it is more doubtful and diagnostic. Okay.
Yes, yes.
And when you are not sure.
Yes, sir. Some foreign body should not be visualized in chest X-rays.
So in that situation, we can find out where the foreign body is located, so we can plan accordingly.
Yes, sir. And complications associated with foreign body ingestion like pneumonia, atelectasis, collapse, this all can be visualized in CT, sir.
Okay. One question is that how do we paralyze or maintain spontaneous the patients? It's better to maintain spontaneous, but lighter plane is more dangerous sometimes. So we can... continuous spontaneous ventilation and add intravenous anesthetic agents like ketamine or propofol. There are some controversy regarding propofol below 3 years, but usually most of the people are using it in a children's age group also. So you have to supplement intravenous anesthetic agents to depend the plane in case duration of bronchoscopy, okay, is duration, okay, take more time. And I think two more questions are there. I'll just take. What if the foreign body is retrieved in piece and not in a single piece? Check bronchoscopy must be in organic foreign body. Yes, check bronchoscopy should be done at the end. Not only the disease long, it has to be done in the contralateral long. Okay, once they retrieve the foreign body, they will go to the other bronchus. Okay, suppose in this case it is right side, they will go to the left side and then again check both the bronchus, both the lungs, and then trachea, they will check it. So always check bronchoscopy has to be done. In same situation. And later, in case it is not, after giving chest physiotherapy and auscultation and repeat X-ray or a ultrasound long, if it is not expanded, then we may have to do again bronchoscopy, which is usually very rare, unless it is very much neglected and patients came very late.
The rate per minute of jet ventilation recommended?
Usually the rate what we used to give for a, suppose a 6 month child, 1 year child, 2 year child, same rate we have to give, which varies between 20 to 30. Okay, usually. It is not a typical jet of high frequency jets. It's just a ventilator, which is usually, which is modified to use it as a jet. Advantage of jet is that there is a minimal leak, okay, so that you can continue throughout the procedures without interruption. But you have to supplement with intravenous anesthetic agent. Same thing for a meningitis, which is basically a original modification of a sender's injector. A sender's injector which you are used, which is now, which is connected to the flow outlet, and we have to do manually. Okay, sometimes it's stuck also. So we have to hold it in one hand. The other hand should be there. Needle should be there at the bronchoscope. The other hand should be there. So any point of time it's stuck, you have to take it out. Nowadays, rarely use sender's injectors. Meningitis is basically a replacement with better features, so which is very safe to use it if you are used to it.
Yes, sir.
Any other question there? Just let me check.
Yes, sir. Someone has asked, what about rapid sequence induction?
Bronchoscopy in rapid sequence in patients. The most important part here is the maintenance of oxygenation throughout the procedure. Okay, ventilation and oxygenation. So it's not practical to continue a rapid sequence induction in this situation. However, only during induction, as you have mentioned here, rapid sequence induction, that point of time, we can continue this Selig's maneuver before this. But in some point of time, you have to remove it because you are going to insert the rigid bronchoscope. And you have to multiple time also, you may have to insert the rigid bronchoscope in case we are not able to retrieve in few attempts, first few attempts. So there are roles, but there is some chance of aspiration. Most of the times, we take care of that as far as possible. But there are some chance of aspiration, which can be... into some extent, we can put an NG tube before ahead and take out the content, but it's not always practical. It depends upon case to case and the situation. What is the role of CT, Badesar? Questions?
About racemic epinephrine, someone has asked, is it available?
Yeah, it's not available easily.
Okay. I think covered almost all the questions, sir. Someone has asked, can we use video laryngoscope? That's
Yes, coming to the flexible scope, okay, and the video laryngoscope. Video laryngoscope is the foreign body which is close to the glottis or just around the glottis, okay, or in oral cavity we can take it out, okay. But beyond that, people are doing it, so putting forceps with the video laryngoscope inside, but with some illuminations, but it's not usually practiced. Coming to the flexible scope, yes, larger size is huge for adult patients, but it's not so practical in a pediatric age groups because the forceps used, okay, will be very small and difficult to retrieve. And like Dormia baskets, both in rigid bronchoscope and also in flexible scope, multiple foreign body when there can be retrieved. There are two types of forceps which are available like a Dormia basket. Once you open it, it is like a Dormia basket, it will open and you can retrieve it visually taking it out. Any other questions in there? Why not atropine? Why glycopyrrolate? Yes, we can give atropine. So the only reason is we'll have more tachycardia. But yes, atropine is definitely a better agent. But glycopyrrolate is very, very sufficient if you are used to this. And really requires, because I have started with atropine for a few years, but now we are used to glycopyrrolate for nearly more than 15 to 20 years. So both are good, but definitely atropine has some advantage, particularly when bradycardia occur, when you are going through glottis, and that's a time, okay, there is high chance of bradycardia any point of time. It's an advantage, but it's not necessary that always you give atropine. Glycopyrrolate is more or less sufficient. Any other questions with that?
I think we have covered all the questions, sir, which are there. I know.
Okay, so here few points to note for all those who are practicing also. We have to know the rigid bronchoscope, the size of the bronchoscope, because the external diameter and internal diameter just don't correlate with our endotracheal tubes. And so any bigger size or smaller size can cause more leak, and bigger size can cause edema. Okay. So we have to coordinate with the surgeon who is doing, which is basically endoscopy. In our setup, it's ENT men or pediatric surgeons and CTPS sometimes do. And make sure that you should put appropriate size, and the communication should be planned before you are taking the patient inside. And if you're already used to the environment, you know that this is the size used, and the surgeons also know, and we keep it very fast. But if you're not used to that, spend some 5 minutes extra and keep the scope ready. All the ventilative scope, everything should be ready, and anesthesiologist, because this is the basically endotracheal tube is moving around the trachus throughout the procedure. It may take 5 minutes, it may take half an hour or 45 minutes. Depends upon the nature of the foreign body, depends upon the experience of the surgeons, and sometime for other causes. So we have to note in details. Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you're audible.
Internet problem, yeah, fine. Okay. So we have to know the rigid bronchoscope in details and these parts, because any interference with this or any manipulation during procedures, there will be difficulty in ventilations, which can cause desaturation and arrest. One thing again I will highlight, history, one of the most important part is must ask any history of unconsciousness or altered sensorium or any history of seizure. Those types of cases more often in respirate. And the desperation can lead to also laryngospasm, sometimes rarely, and also in the bed long. In this situation, you may require to optimize the patients if patient is relatively stable before taking the case. Sometimes we take 3 to 4 days or 1 week also. If not possible, you have to take the case. You may require a postoperative ventilatory supports and antibiotic therapy, including culture, and culture you have to send because patients aspirated the stomach content. Okay, and rarely seizure can cause also some tongue edema because of biting of the tongue. So we may expect a difficult ARV situation in a bronchoscopy also. Role of glyco is anti-secretory, CPCR in this case, role of defibrillator in this case. Yes, defibrillator is usually not used below 8 years. Okay, the pedal which is there available between 2 to 8 years, sorry, 2 to 8 years, but below 2 years role is limited. We have to keep the defibrillator ready always. And that's the standard procedure. So I think she missed it. Okay. I missed it. And next is, okay, fine. CPCR. It's most important cause here is hypoxia. It's if you communicate properly with surgeons, you planned it. Arrest is rare. We have only, what do we remember last 20 years, one arrest, which is because of communication gap when a senior residents, which is new to that, okay, who took in a hurry without discussing. Okay, that situation only, otherwise arrest is rare. If you communicate, plan it well, and you are experienced enough over time, okay, under supervision of your seniors. So definitely you will able to do all types of cases, including the tracheal foreign body, which is very big enough, and patient may be desaturating up to 70 or close to 76-75. You are below that with a very high tachycardia or sometime bradycardia and arrhythmia, and two cases of arrested cases also can be revived. It's not that not revived, which are brought from outside in a very bad condition. It's quite a good communication, understanding all this, and having this institution using it for atrial ventilation for more than 40-50 years, one of the highest in many rare. Okay, and so we have a good exposure and getting more number of cases. This is what we found, but arrest is very rare unless and until you not plan it and you give to a both sides, for the surgeon or anesthesiologist or both, which are less experienced or inexperienced, okay, or they did not took advice or help of the seniors. So always take up help of seniors, and with times all of you learn, those who are not used to this, including the many of the pass out MD, those who are not used to this, they will definitely get opportunity when they are working in some institutes where all these facilities are available.
I think we have covered almost all the questions. We have come to an end of the webinar. Any final thoughts on this, Nivedita madam, or can we? Mishra sir?
No, tracheobronchial tree is, tracheobronchial foreign body is really a troublesome to the anesthesiologist. And especially if the young baby has come, then definitely it is a tension. And with meticulous management and with all the, with care, definitely we can come over and we will definitely, there will be no problem. But however, I will, with my personal experience, I will tell you, there are certain institutions are there where there are no such high-handed instruments are there. And with the rigid bronchoscope to do or a fiber optic to get and do, it becomes really troublesome. So in that situation, what does the Sandeep says? That's what I wanted to know.
First of all, three things, ma'am. One is infrastructures. If it is available, it's good. And the experienced surgeons also important, as the anesthesiologist also, because anesthesiologist is very big in tracheobronchial foreign body. One of these things which can change the patient life. So it's always better to refer to a center where close to this as far as possible. If in case inexperience, it's better to not to do, because within few seconds or 2 minutes, we may lose the patient child, and which 100% going to survive. Okay, maintaining a 70 to something around 80% oxygen with SpO2, we can sit with oxygen with ambulance. Definitely, child is going to survive, because within few hours, patients will be taken to operation theater and the foreign body will be out. And this setup required. Yes, when we came here somewhere around 18 years back to Jipmer, I think most of the place in southern part was not using it. But nowadays, I found many of people are using bronchoscope, rigid bronchoscope, both ventilating bronchoscope mainly. And JT is very rarely used by others, but this institution use it for years, and it's a very safe practice. You can, if you are used to this, both MenoJets and the automated jets, which is not that easily available nowadays, which is basically prepared by some Indian company, but it's really useful. Mainly throughout procedures, you don't have to think about depth more, and you continue it. So that's like your endotracheal intubation, you did everything settled, you just come down for some time once operation started. But still, the most important for both postgraduates and all, bit to bit, we have to see the chest expansion throughout, auscultate it repeatedly, see the monitors, communication between both, and what procedures is going on each time. Whether this bronchoscope is inside the bronchus, inside the trachea, or coming out, you should know, and it's only by communicating with the surgeons repeatedly. And many, we should not, one thing important is surgeons should not go on doing it without communicating with you. So good communication is very, very important. A 5 to 10 minutes job or half an hour job, patients should be totally all right. Including glottic edema patients, you just observe for some 20 to 30 minutes in the post anesthetic care units with a good nebulization and steroids. They don't require intubations. It's also very rare.
Thank you, Vijayalakshmi. Such a wonderful
time. Yeah, thank you a lot, madam, for that excellent discussion. Sandeep Mishra sir, a last question by Ashok Bade sir, role of flexible fiber optic bronchoscopy removal.
Yeah, I think
probably 30 seconds so that we can unwind.
Flexible by fiber optic bronchoscope in particularly age of 2 years in this case for children's diagnostic is definitely it's going to help. Okay. where the foreign body is located. But in one shot you can take out with a digital bronchoscope, so less useful. But retrieving the foreign body is not that practical with a flexible 5-dot bronchoscope, unless and until this is big enough, okay, which is around 5.6 or above 7 size, which is not possible to insert in a child of 2 to 3 years. Its role in adult patients and a larger child is definitely there, and different types of forces are available, and AVAC patients also, we can retrieve the foreign body without minimal sedation anesthesia, we can retrieve it, mainly for a larger child and particularly for adult patients.
Okay, sir. Thank you very much. So it was an excellent discussion we had today by both the chairpersons, and a very good presentation by Imaya, and all the very best for a bright future, Imaya. That was a good presentation, and it reminded me of those numerous cases which I myself had done at Jipmer, a very tough one which had a VSD with a foreign body also. It was a very interesting one which we had done. So with this, I think we had come to an end to today's webinar, and I would now wish to request our secretary, Dr. Vishal Singla, if he'll permit me to present the vote of thanks.
I thank all the organizer and Dr. Vijayalakshmi special, Nivetha madam, and all the audience who was watching. Okay, 2 minutes. Listening
through. Thank you, Vijayalakshmi. Thank you, Shandi. And I all my blessings to the postgraduate who has presented so well.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
So, with permission from the secretary, Dr. Vishal Singla.
Please, ma'am.
Can I present the vote of thanks? Yeah. So, a home could never be built without the strong foundation and support. And this RSCCP family had always been such a sturdy support and base for all of us to organize and conduct and network. So ever grateful to our founders, Dr. Tej K. Kaul sir and HL Kaul sir. Thank you very much. I place and record my immense gratitude to our very dynamic president, RSCCP, Professor Indrani Hemant Kumar madam, for always being there, rendering her insights and suggestions, and being a true hand-holding patron for all the academic endeavors we conduct under RSCCP. Thank you, madam. I wish to express my sincere thanks to our respected president-elect of RSCCP, Professor Ravin Malhotra, sir, who has been the backbone of RSCCP and its achievements. Thank you, sir. I express my gratitude to our beloved Vice President of RSCCP, Dr. Anju Grewal, madam, for her unflinching effort in helping RSCCP to reach new heights. Thank you, madam. And I wish to thank our young and dynamic National Secretary, Dr. Vishal Singla, for his ever available guidance and insights. Thank you, Vishal. I also wish to thank the Editor-in-Chief, JOSCP, Dr. Pradeep Bhatia, sir, for his support and encouragement. Thank you, sir. Sincere and heartfelt thanks to each and every of our RSCCP GC members for their steadfast support. Thank you to each one of you. I wish to thank my HOD and present Medical Superintendent of IGMCRI, Rajesh Joseph, sir, for his consistent encouragement in our efforts on behalf of RSCCP Puducherry. Thank you, sir. And wish to thank the pillars of today's webinar, the eminent faculty speakers, the chairpersons, and also the postgraduate who have shared their knowledge on today's forum and helped make this webinar a success. Thank you all. Last but not the least, I wish to sincerely thank each and every one of all of the delegates who have attended this webinar and actively participated in the discussions. And we solicit your continuing support towards all the future RSCCP academic sessions. Thank you, one and all. Looking forward to meet you all once again for the next academic webinar. And long live RSCCP.
Thank you, Vijayalakshmi. With this, I'll just add thank you, Bade sir, because I think we people have learned over years, more than two decades of hundreds of cases of tracheobronchial foreign body under him, and he is more than 40-45 years of experience. And all of we have learned, okay, all techniques, the long back, okay, and he has also learned many things over time and shared with us. And thank you, sir. Thank you very much, and thank you all.
Thank you, Sandeep. Thank you, Vijayalakshmi. Actually, I could have interacted a little more, but I had to leave in between for some work.
Yes, sir. Without you, whenever you go to anywhere and foreign body discuss all over India, I feel somewhere I am missing Dr. Bade, because
Dr. Vishal, actually, Bade sir is
the time and methods is always we what we have learned over decades, and we always share with others.
I think CT and virtual bronchoscopy was mentioned because I had to go out in between.
Yes, sir. Actually, we just skipped the from X-ray. I did not ask CT, but she was aware of that CT and virtual bronchoscopy.
Yeah,
did not discuss in details.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you all. Thank you.
Thank you very much to each and all of you for the wonderful presentation we have had, ma'am. And it was so well-crafted, well-organized webinar. And that brings us to the end of not only this webinar, but also to the end of this PG-oriented exam webinar series. And the success, of course, can be gauged through the number of viewers we had, the all-time high types, YouTube views, number of participants here. So we had a very good web series. And I would especially like to congratulate team Pondicherry, Dr. Vijayalakshmi ma'am, for the very well organized and very well series. Dr. Sandeep Mishra sir, lesser I speak the better, I guess. No point uncovered. And Dr. Debendra Tripathi sir, Dr. Rekha Das madam, Dr. Nibedita Tapani ma'am. It was all a wonderful academic feast. And there's another big day coming on 24th of July. That is the RSCP Foundation Day. We're planning something, and hopefully as soon as the next events are decided, we'll be putting on the flyers onto the groups. So thank you very much. Long live RSCP, and good night. Please take very good care of yours. Thank you very much. Good night.
Thank you.
Long live RSCP.
Long live.